If you are my subscriber, you already know me that I do create videos mostly on trending and popular components that you find in different websites. But in this video, let's do some fun thing. Let's create this scratch coupon card animation. So for this animation, we'll be using HTML Canvas. Without further ado, let's start. Hello and namaste everyone, this is Jitsaru with Coding Design. Welcome to our channel. If you are new here, please be sure to hit that subscribe button. Let's create index.html file. Inside that, if I type exclamation sign and hit that tab button, then you will get this basic HTML code. Now let's give the title. For the title, I am giving scratch coupon card animation. Now within the body tag, let's create div with class name card. And within that, I am creating another div with class name code. Next to that, let's create canvas element with id cover. Now within the div with class name code, let's create two more elements. I'm giving paragraph tag and let's write coupon code. Just below that, let's create h2 heading, and within that I'm giving random coupon code. Now with the help of live server extension, let's open this index.html file in our default browser. As you can see, this is our result. Now in order to give some proper styling, let's create the style.css file. Just below the title tag, let's give link for our style.css file. Within the style.css file, I'm creating root pseudo class. Within that, let's declare variable name secondary color, and I'm giving Alice blue color. For the universal selector, in order to prevent browser's default margin and padding, I'm giving margin and padding of 0. Similarly, let's give box size into border box. And also for the body, let's give minimum height of 100 viewport height. For the background color, let's keep that same secondary color variable. In order to bring that content exactly at the center, I'm giving display grid, press items to center. But you can see now it is not exactly at the center. It's because I'm not giving proper height and width for our div with class name card. I think I need to change that font family, so let's keep font family of sans serif. Now we need to give some styles for this div with class name card. Code as well as canvas with id cover. So for the div with class name card, let's give width and height of 20 rem, square making square shape card. For the background color, I'm giving white color. In order to create that rounded corners, let's give border radius of 0.8 rem. And also I want to give some box shadow. For that, for the x offset, I'm giving 0. For the y offset, 0.3 rem. For the blur value, let's give 0.8 rem. And for the color, let's give this black color with alpha value. Similarly, for the div with class name code, I'm giving position of absolute. Now for the class card, you can give position of relative, because as you know, this is our parent element. And for the class card, now let's give width and height of 100%. So we are giving the same parent's width and height. Now in order to bring that text exactly at the center, I'm giving display flakes. Let's give flex direction to column, and also justify content to center. Now you can see it is vertically centered. In order to make it horizontally centered, you can give text align to center. So now you can see this exactly at the center of your card. Now let's style that canvas element with id cover. So before that, I want to give the same CSS property for both this class code and for the id cover. So you can select this code and take it up there. Be careful, I'm using the comma because we are sharing the same properties. Now for the canvas with id cover, let's give outline. I'm giving outline width to 1 rem. For this style, let's give dotted. And for the color, let's give the same secondary variable. And also let's give outline offset. I'm giving minus 0.5 rem. Now in your browser, you can see it's now more than card, okay? We are getting a kind of ticket shape or coupon shape. Now everything is ready, but in order to give that scratching coupon card animation, I want to create script.js file. So now let's link this JavaScript file. Just above the end of body tag, let's give the source of our JavaScript file. Now within the script.js file, we need to get this canvas element with id cover. So for that, I'm creating constant variable canvas, and I'm assigning document.getElementById, and let's pass that id cover. I'm using their comma so that I don't have to keep that constant keyword multiple times. So let's create another variable CTX, or you can call it context, and I'm assigning canvas.getContext. Now with the help of this, you'll be able to create context for our canvas, and you'll be able to use different properties, methods related to this context, okay? And within that, you can give 2D. Now let's give the proper width and height for our canvas element. So for that, I'm writing canvas.height is equal to canvas.offsetHeight. And also let's give width for our canvas. For that, let's duplicate this code. And instead of that height, let's give width. Okay, that offset height, that must be capital H. As you can see in our styled CSS file, I have given their width and height of 100%. So based on this value, it will automatically add up its width and height. Now let's give linear gradient color. For that, first of all, let's create gradient color. For that, I'm creating another constant variable gradient, and I'm assigning ctx dot. As you can see, we have already created that variable, and you can write dot create linear gradient. For the first two parameters, it will take the starting x and y coordinate. So for the starting coordinates, I'm giving 0. And for the second two parameters, it will take the ending or final coordinates. So for the x coordinate, I'm giving canvas.width. And for the y coordinate, let's give canvas.height. So now that two zeros that represents the starting position, that means we are starting from top left corner of our canvas. And for the second two parameters, where I have given canvas width and height, that is our ending position. So we are taking it to bottom right corner of our canvas. So now we need to give different colors for our linear gradient color. For that, you can write something like gradient.addColorStop. Be careful, we are using their camo cache. And within that, for the first parameter, you can give starting amount of color that you want to give. So it has to range from 0 to 1. I'm giving 0. For the second parameter, you can give color name or color code as you like. I'm giving pink. And now let's give the other color. Let's duplicate the same code. For that amount of color, you can give 1, but I want to give 0.7. And let's change that pink color to magenta. In this way, we have created our gradient color. Now it's time to create rectangle shape, and we need to give that gradient color for our rectangle. You can write something like ctx.fillStyle, so you can give that same gradient color. And with the help of that ctx.fillRect, you'll be able to create rectangle shape. For the first parameter, you have to give the x coordinate, and for the second parameter, you have to give y coordinate. I'm giving there 0 because I want to start from top left corner of our canvas. Similarly, for the third parameter, you need to give width for our rectangle. I think for that, we can copy this same code that we have give for our gradient and paste it there. So for the fourth parameter, it will take the height. So I'm giving the canvas.height. It means we are creating rectangle shape that will occupy whole our canvas. And in our browser, okay, there is no any changes. Why is that? Let me check in the console. Okay, there's some problem. As you can see, I have given their document.getElementById, and now I don't have to give that hashtag. So you don't need to give that hash. Just remove that. And ta-da! Did you see that? In your browser, you are getting that beautiful gradient color. But if you don't like this color, like, you can just give your own favorite color. Now, when you scratch, I mean, when you move your mouse around our canvas element, now we need to give a kind of scratch animation. For that, first of all, we need to get the exact position of our mouse. Again, you can take that canvas and you can write dot add event listener. So we are listening to the mouse move event. And for the second parameter, let's give the callback. Within that, I'm passing E as event that represents our mouse move event. And I'm writing get pose. So that will be our function. And along with that, let's pass the argument E. So that same event. Okay. But as you can see, I haven't created that function. So for that, just above, let's create that function. Again, within that function, let's pass that event argument, and within that function, okay, before detecting x and y coordinate of our mouse, I mean position of our mouse, I think we need to create a variable. For that, I'm writing let x is equal to null. So initially, for the x variable, we'll give null, and also I'm giving the same thing for our y variable. Now, as soon as that get position function triggers, we will change that x and y variables value. I'm writing x is equal to e.pageX. Again, we are using their camel case, and also for the y, you can give their e.pageY. So initially, you can see for the x and y, we have given there null, but as soon as when you move your mouse, we'll change that x and y variables value. And after detecting that position of our mouse, again let's call another function scratch, and we'll pass that position of our mouse, so you can pass there x comma y. So after detection, we are again passing that x and y position of our mouse, I mean x and y coordinates of our mouse within our function scratch. But as you can see, we haven't created that scratch function, so now let's create that function again. Now we need to take that x and y coordinates within that function as argument, and again I'm writing ctx.beginPath. So now I'm trying to create circle shape. For that, we are starting the path, and now again you can give ctx.arc. So with the help of this function, now you'll be able to create circular shape. For the first two parameter, you can give the x and y position of our circle. For that, I'm giving x and y. So when we were moving our mouse at that time, we did detect our x and y coordinates of our mouse, and we are passing the same x and y position of our mouse. And for the third parameter, you can give the radius. For that, I'm passing the variable name radius. But as you can see, I haven't created that variable name radius. So now let's create that variable name radius, and I'm passing there 14. So we are giving the radius of 14. And for the fourth parameter, you can give the starting angle, I'm giving 0. And for the fifth parameter, you can give ending angle, and I'm giving 360. That means we are starting from 0 degree to 360. As you have already know that 360 degree, that makes the complete round circle. And instead of that 360, you could give 2 into math.py. So it's the same thing. Now we need to give the final code. I'm writing ctx.fill. Before that, let's give background color for our circular shape. For that, I can write something like ctx.fillStyle. So let's give the gold color. Now in your browser, did you see that? Now when you move your mouse around that canvas element, you'll be able to create circular shape. But that circle shape, that is not exactly at the center of your mouse. In order to bring that circular shape exactly at the center of your mouse, we have to make some changes in x and y variables value. Again, I'm creating constant variable, so I'm using object destructuring with the help of that curly bracket. So first of all, let's get the object. You can write something like canvas.getBoundingClientRect. So with the help of this method, now you'll be able to get different properties of our canvas, something like x coordinate, y coordinates, width, height, you know, something like that. So I can get the left and top value. So within curly bracket, I can write left comma top. So I'm getting the left and top value of our canvas element. And now you can take the same left value and we can subtract from our page x value. Similarly, for the y coordinate, you can take that top and we can subtract from our page y value. Now did you see that our circle shape, that is exactly at the center of our mouse? So this is exactly what I want. But as you know, we are creating scratch coupon card animation, but instead of scratching, we are drawing fat lines. So now instead of adding that lines within our canvas, we will subtract it. For that, within scratch function, you can write something like ctx.globalCompositeOperation is equal to, you can give the string destination out. So now with the help of this code, instead of adding that line within our canvas, now we will subtract. Okay, did you see that? Now we did add our scratch animation, but there is one problem. As soon as you move your mouse within our canvas element, you will immediately get that scratching animation. But I want something like, as soon as you click and drag your mouse at that time, I want that effect. Okay, so for that, you can duplicate the same code and bring it up there. Now let's close our bracket and let's remove that curly bracket. We don't need that event, let's remove that. Now instead of mouse move event, let's give mouse down event. So before executing any code, first of all, let's create a variable name easy scratching. And initially I'm giving false. Now you can take that same variable name. Let's change that easy scratching variable's value to true. And also let's give another event. Let's duplicate the same code and let's change that mouse down event to mouse up. So when you click and release your mouse at that time, let's change that easy scratching variable's value back to false. And depending upon that easy scratching variable's value, we'll execute other codes, something like detecting position of our mouse and creating that scratching animation. So within that mouse move event, let's give the if condition. And I'm giving exclamation sign and easy scratching. That means if we are not scratching, let's give the return keyword. So with the help of this code, if we are not scratching, then we won't execute further code, we will just return. So once again in our browser, Whenever you are moving your mouse near to that canvas element, you won't be able to get that scratching animation. But as soon as when you click and drag your mouse, you'll be able to get that scratching animation, okay? But what if you want to give shadow? For that, in our standard CSS file, for the ID cover, you can give their filter. I'm giving drop shadow. For the X offset, I'm giving 0. For the Y offset, 0.2 rem. For the blur value, I'm giving 0.1 rem. For the color, let's give black color. You can see that box shadow, I think this is too much. For the Y offset, instead of that 0.2 rem, let's give 0. Let's take it to the full screen by pressing F11 key. And if you scratch, okay, I think it's better. But if your users, they are using touch screen devices, at that time, it won't work, okay? Because all the events that we have gave, that was for our mouse. So we need to give extra event for our touch screen devices. For that, again, let's declare another variable. Okay, I think I have done some mistake there. Now instead of that semicolon, you have to give the comma. Again, at the bottom, let's give comma and let's create the variable. So I'm giving events. Let's create object, okay? Within that, again, I'm creating object. Let's give touch. And let's give the different key value. Let's give down. For the down, let's give touch start. And for the second key, I'm giving move. For the value, let's give touch move. And for the third key, I'm giving up. For the value, touch end. Similarly, for the mouse event, let's select hold this code and duplicate it. And don't forget to give their comma. Instead of that touch, you can change it to mouse. So now for the mouse down event, you can change it to mouse down. For the mouse move event, instead of that touch move, let's give mouse move. And also instead of that touch end, let's give mouse up event. So again, we have created different events for our mouse and also for our touch screen devices, and we have stored within our events variable. Now in browser, we need to detect touch screen devices. Once again, I'm giving their comma and let's create another variable, event type, and I'm assigning, let's give a string on. We can take any one of our touch event. I'm taking that touch start event.
Keep on.
And if I give in window, and I'm writing there question mark. So I'm using ternary operator. With the help of this code, we will detect whether our users, they are using touch screen devices or not, okay? If they are using, then it will return true. Otherwise, it will return false. So if it's true, then we'll return a string touch. Otherwise, we'll return a string mouse. Don't forget to keep their colon, okay? Now we can take the help of this variable event type and trigger different events. Now instead of our mouse down, mouse up, and mouse move event, based on our event types, we'll give different events. Now by holding Alt key or Option key, you can click on specific events. Let's remove this code. Instead, let's give events. So we are taking that object, events, and you can give curly bracket. Let's pass event type. So based on that type, so don't forget to give their dot. So we are accessing that different events from our object events. Let's remove that single code. Whether it is touch or mouse, based on that, we'll trigger our touch event and mouse events. So that is exactly what is going on there. I hope you get the concept. So once again, in our browser, everything is working fine. But if you love like simplicity, you can comment that code. And I think without that drop shadow, it is better. So let me know in the comment box, did you love this animation without drop shadow or with drop shadow? In order to show you what's really going on, I have kept their golden background color. Otherwise, it was not necessary. So let's remove that. And also you can add some extra features. Something like you can generate that random unique code. I mean coupon code. So with the help of this code, you can generate random code. But if you want to know what's really going on, then I have created multiple videos. You know, I think more than 3 or 4 videos where I have shown you how to generate different unique random strings. So all the videos link will be even in the description below. So you don't have to watch whole video. I'll give you links with different timestamps so you can check out. So that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you did learn something, smash that like button. If you have any kind of queries, let me know in the comment box. Share this video if you think someone needs it. And also, if you haven't already yet, hit that subscribe button and also the notification bell icon. Remember, there is always more to learn. So keep learning.